Hello everyone, welcome back. Today I'm going to explain a new module, that is limit state of collapse due to flexure. In this module, we are going to study about limit state of collapse, that is by flexure. Before going to analysis of beam in flexure, first we need to know about the types and behavior of the flexural members. First of all, what is flexure? Flexure is nothing but it's a pure bending. Okay, let me explain about types of flexural failure. Here we have four different kinds of flexural failure. Under that, the first one is fracture of steel in tension, fracture of under reinforced section, fracture of over reinforced section, and other failures. Here we will start with the first one, that is fracture of steel in tension. How this fracture of steel will occur is, that is how it fails. Sudden failure of PSC member without warning is due to fracture of steel in tension zone. How it has occurred? First of all, it's a sudden failure, and the second point tells about why it fails. That is, this type of failure occur when steel provided is so less that when cracks in the tension zone, where crack occurs is it occurs in the tension zone, a steel will not be in position to take the additional load. Due to this, the failure will occur. And next is, this type of failure is prevented by providing a certain minimum percentage of steel. How it can be, failure can be avoided? By providing a minimum percentage of steel, we can avoid the failure. The fourth point is, see, according to IS 1343-1980, minimum longitudinal steel is 0.2% in all cases except in case of small pre-tensioned cases. The minimum longitudinal steel should be 0.2% except small pre-tensioned cases. The fifth point is, for high yield strength deformed reinforcement, it is limited to 0.15. Just now we had studied that that is minimum should be 0.2%. Here we are reducing it to 0.15%. It is just because it is a high yield strength reinforcement. So because of this high yield, we can reduce it to 0.15%. The next failure is fracture of under reinforced section. First of all, we know that under reinforced section means it can be defined in two different parameters. Under reinforced itself we can define in two parameters, that is, the first one is, it depends on the neutral axis. That is, when the depth of the neutral axis is less than the limiting depth of neutral axis, that is, XU is less than XU limit, it can be called as under reinforced. The second parameter is moment of resistance. Ultimate moment of resistance is less than ultimate moment of ultimate moment of resistance is less than limiting moment of resistance, then those type of section is under reinforced. In other words, I can also say it as MU is less than MU limit. When XU is less than XU limit, these two parameters, in these two conditions, it comes under reinforced section. Okay. In the first point, if the cross section is provided with an amount of steel greater than the minimum reinforcement, the failure is characterized by excessive elongation of steel followed by crushing of concrete. It is given that in under-reinforced section, the steel reinforcement will take the load first. Then it starts elongating after it reaches the yield value. Then the concrete will start taking load and it fails due to crushing. This is what they had given in the first point. And then in the second point, the members approaches failure due to gradual reduction and compression zone exhibiting large deflections and cracks which is developed at the soffit. That is, when there is large deflection and cracks in the tension zone, that is, tension zone is present at the bottom, due to the reduction of reinforcement in compression zone, this type of failure will occurs. The third point is, when area of concrete in compression zone is insufficient, the ultimate flexural failure takes place through crushing concrete. The area or concrete is not sufficient for in the compression zone, then this type of failure will occur. The fourth point is, large deflections and wide crack are the characteristic features of under reinforced section at failure. Due to large deflection as well as wide cracks, these kind of failure will occur in under reinforced section. The fifth one is, this type of behavior is generally desirable since there will be considerable warning before failure. Actually, usually in the civil engineering structure, we always prefer under reinforced section, because in this section we know that the longitudinal steel will start taking the load and the deflection will takes place till it reaches its yield value. Then the concrete will start taking load, which leads to failure. So in this case, since the steel is taking load first, it gives enough warning and time to take the action against the failure. So we always prefer under reinforced section. The third failure is fracture of over reinforced section. Here also, over reinforced section depends on two parameters, that is, one is neutral axis and one is moment of resistance. In neutral axis, when the depth of neutral axis is more than the limiting depth of neutral axis, that is, XU is greater than XU limit, then it is called as over reinforced section. Then when it comes to moment of resistance, ultimate moment of resistance is greater than limiting moment of resistance, that is, MU is greater than MU limit, then it comes under reinforced section. So this is the general thing about the over reinforced section. So let's start with the points. That is, when effective reinforcement index exceeds a certain range of values, the sections is said to be over reinforced section. Here they are telling that the reinforced index, like neutral axis depth, moment of resistance, will be greater than the permissible limiting value. So it is called as over reinforced section. And in over reinforced section, always concrete will take the load first, then it reaches the yield value, then steel will start taking the load. Since the concrete is taking the load first, and we know that the concrete is weak in tension and brittle, the material will lead to sudden failure without any warning. So usually over reinforced section is not preferred. Under reinforced is always preferred. The next point is, generally over-reinforced section fails by sudden cracking of concrete, which is characterized by small deflection and narrow cracks. The area of steel being comparatively large, the stresses developed in the steel at failure of member may not reach the tensile strength. Just now, whatever I have explained, it is related to this point. The third point is, in structural concrete member, it is undesirable for sudden failure without any warning in the form of executive deflections and widespread cracks. The fourth one is, consequently, the use of over-reinforced section is discourageous. We don't prefer over-reinforced section. We always prefer under-reinforced sections. The fourth and the final failure is other kind of a failure. What are the other types of failures is, pre-stressed concrete member subjected to transverse load may fail in shear before their full strength is attained if they are not adequately designed for shear. Web shear cracks may develop if the principal stresses are excessive and if their webs are used. The failure may occur, it should be due to web crushing. Yes, usually the failure is due to web shear cracks, because of the excessive failure in this stress in the web and all, this kind of failure is observed. And the third point is, in case of pre-tensioned members, failure of bond between steel and surrounding concrete is likely due to inadequate transmission length at end of members. In post-tension members, anchorage failure may take place if end block is not properly designed to resist the transverse tensile forces. You know that in a pre-tensioned member, the bond between steel and the concrete is inadequate. Okay, if it is not up to the mark, then this kind of the failure will occur. And in the post-tension, because of the anchorage failure, this kind of a anchorages, there is a failure in post-tension members. This is all about the failures, four different kinds of failures. The next thing is, flexural strength, moment of resistance of pre-stressed concrete beams. The first point is for a rectangular section. So according to that, I have written a rectangle section having a width B, depth D, effective depth is D, XU is distance of the neutral axis. At what distance neutral axis is there? That is XU. AP is nothing but area of pre-stressing cable. Here, why we use this formula is, that is, first of all, the moment of resistance can be denoted by MR or M. Both are same, equal to FPU into AP into D minus 0.42 into XU. This is a formula for rectangular section. Why do we use this formula itself means, always neutral axis will be present inside the rectangle section. Because of that reason, we are using this formula where B and D is nothing but width and effective depth, AP, area of pre-stressing cable, XU, depth of neutral axis, FPU, ultimate tensile stress in the tendon, FP characteristic strength of cable, FPE effectively pre-stressing stress after all the losses. First of all, we should be thorough with these terms, that is FPU, FP, FPE. These things is like we will be using these terms frequently, so we should know these terms. And also, as I mentioned here, this formula is available in page 59 in IS 1343 codebook. So go there. If you check page 59, we will get this moment of resistance for a rectangular section. Now the next thing is, the value of FPU depends on effective reinforcement ratio, where we know that FPU is nothing but ultimate tensile stress in the tendon. Okay, that ultimate tensile stress of the tendon depends on effective reinforcement ratio. This is called effective reinforcement ratio. And why do we use this? Is in as I told, IS 1343 codebook in page 59, we have a table like table 11. There we come across this ratio. So first of all, let me read this. For pre-tensioned and post-tensioned members with effective bond between steel and concrete, FPU and XU values are obtained from given table 11, that is page number 59 and appendix of IS 1343 1980. The effective pre-stress after all loss should not be less than 0.45 FP. What they are telling here is, as I told, if we go to IS 1343 page 59 table 11, we will get this ratio. First of all, why do we require this ratio? Is to find out the XU, that is distance of the neutral axis, and FPU is ultimate tensile stress in the tendon. To find out these two terms, we require this ratio. But while referring to that table, we should be, and that table is purely for effective bond tendons. Okay, if the bond is, if they have given in the question, if they have given it as effective bond, we should refer to the table 11. Under that, we have a pre-tension as well as a post-tension member. According to those two conditions, we should refer to the table 11. Next thing is, for post-tensioned members with unbonded tendons, the value of FPU and XU value are given in table 12, which depends on effective span to depth ratio, that is L by D. That is, in table 12, first of all, why do we use this table 12? Is when the question is unbonded tendons, post tension member with unbonded tendons, if they give this, then we should refer to table 12. From table 12, what values we will get, or what information we get, is it is regarding FPU and XU. About these two terms, we will get the value from table 12. But the thing is, here we refer L by D ratio. Okay, that is span by depth ratio. By having this value, span by depth ratio, we can calculate FP, or we can extract the values of FPU and XU by interpolating the values. Here L by D ratio plays an important role. Here effective reinforcement ratio plays an important role in table 11. So the next one is, the second point is flanged section. Flange section may be a T section or it can be a I section. Here whatever diagram you can see, it is a standard stress block parameter, which is you have already studied this in RCC. So this is a standard stress block parameters for flanged section. Okay, so let's focus on this. That is, AP is area of pre-stressing cable, BF width of flange, DF depth of flange, BW width of web, XU depth of neutral axis, FPU ultimate tensile stress in tendons, FP characteristic strength of cable, FPE effectively pre-stressing stress after all losses. So these, what are these terms we have understood? So let's go to formula. Here, before writing the formula, what we can see is, it is C1, C2, A1, A2 in the diagram, where C1 and C2 is nothing but a compressive forces. Each compressive forces C1 have a different value, that is equal to 0.36 into FCK into BW into XU. Then for C2 it is equal to 0.45 FCK BF minus BW into DF, where A1 and A2 is nothing but lever arm distance. Lever arm distance A1 is D minus 0.42 XU, A2 is D minus DF by 2. So these terms comes here, so we should be knowing the values. Okay, after that we have a two different cases. That is, this is for a flanged section. Okay, T section or I section, that is called as a flange section. So don't forget, when you get the flange section condition, you should solve a problem like this. That is, case one is, neutral axis lies within the flange. First of all, in this T section, this horizontal member is called as a flange and this vertical member is called as a web. Now the first case is, neutral axis will be lying within this flange. Okay, we are just thinking that if neutral axis is present in the flange, what will be the moment of resistance formula? So the condition for that is, XU is nothing but depth of neutral axis. XU is less than DF, that is, depth of neutral axis is less than effective depth, overall depth of the flange. So if XU is less than DF, then it is like, this portion is like a rectangle. This flange is like a rectangle. So obviously we should take this. If it is looking like a rectangle beam section, then we should go for moment of resistance equal to M equal to FPU into AP into D minus 0.42 XU is a formula when the neutral axis is lying within the flange. And this is the same formula which we have written in rectangular section. The second case is, neutral axis lies within the web. That is, the neutral axis will be here in the web. If that is a condition, what is the case here? It is, XU is greater than DF. XU is depth of neutral axis, that is greater than depth of the flange. Yes, when it is present, neutral axis is present in the web, it is obviously understood that it is greater than depth of the flange. So what we should do is, we should consider the area of the cable, that is AP equal to APW plus APF, where AP is area of the cable. We have already seen area of pre-stressing cable. So APW is area of the cable for web. APF, area of the cable for flange. Okay. If we get the total area of the cable, from that we should divide few percentage for the web, few percentage for the little percentage for flange. Okay, like that we can calculate APW, APF, where APF is equal to 0.45 FCK BF minus BW into DF by FP. This is a equation for APF. This is equation 1, this is equation 2. From equation 1 and 2, we can calculate APW. Okay, as I said, if we know AP and APF is calculated by this formula, then obviously we can calculate or we can find out APW. If the neutral axis lies in the web, the moment of resistance formula is MR equal to FPU into APW into D minus 0.42 into XU plus FP into APF into D minus DF by 2. This is a formula for neutral axis lying in the web. Okay. The last thing is about the effective reinforcement ratio. I have already shown this in table. When we are referring to the table, this ratio is important. I had said I'm talking about the same ratio, that is AP into FP by BD FCK is a ratio that will be equal to APW FP by BW D FCK. You can see a changes here. AP I have changed it to APW, where B I have changed it to BW. That is nothing but area of the web, area of the cable for the web and width of the web. Okay, these two things are important, that these modifications should be done when the neutral axis is lying in the web. Okay, this is how we use the formula for solving a problem or to find out a moment of resistance for a rectangle section or a flange section and all. Okay, hope you have understood. Thank you.